In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Before we study from God's Word this morning, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we will read. Father in heaven, I pray for each person here that none of us will come up to the day of judgment and find out that we were not ready and that we are lost. Help us to realize the seriousness of life. And I pray that your Spirit will teach us the truth as we study now and give us the heart to obey and follow you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to study with you four things this morning. The first thing I want to study with you is the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount is found in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Now, obviously, we're not going to study every verse in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. But that's where that's the only place, by the way, that the Sermon on the Mount is found in the Bible. The Gospel of Luke has a few bits and pieces of the Sermon on the Mount here and there, especially in chapter 6. But the Gospel of Matthew is the only book in the Bible that has the entire Sermon on the Mount in order. It starts in Matthew 5:1 and it goes to the last verse of chapter 7. Matthew 5, 6, and 7. So that's the first thing we're going to study, is the Sermon on the Mount. Here's the second thing we're going to study. The second thing we're going to study is we're going to find out that one of the major subjects that Jesus dealt with in the Sermon on the Mount was the Ten Commandments. The law, the commandments. That is one of his major subjects that he deals with in the Sermon on the Mount. It's the second thing we're going to study. Here's the third thing we're going to study. The third thing that we're going to study is that in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus taught that the commandments can be broken by thought and by speech, as well as by actions. A lot of people, when they read the commandments, they think, well, that's talking about your actions. My late sister-in-law, Lillian Grosboll, had experience one time. She was in nursing school. Excuse me, she'd already graduated, actually, from nursing school, and this happened. And there was a professional person talking, and this is in a medical situation. And this person said to the other people around, he said, "You can think whatever you want to, but don't do it." And that is worldly wisdom. That is what the people of this world think. You can think anything you want, as long as you don't do it. That is not the Christian religion. The Christian religion teaches the exact opposite of that. So the third thing we're going to study is that Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount that the commandments can be broken by thought and by speech, in addition to by action. That's the third thing we're going to study. And the fourth thing we're going to study is this. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus taught that only commandment keepers will be in the kingdom of heaven. Now, I didn't say that. Jesus Christ said that in the Sermon on the Mount, and it's in very plain language, and we will read it. And remember, the third thing we're going to study is what? The commandments may be broken how? By thought or by speech, in addition to by actions. Now, before we get started, let's think that through a little bit. Let's think through the third and fourth things we're going to study. If the commandments can be broken by thought or by speech in addition to actions, And if only commandment keepers will be in the kingdom of heaven, do I need to get in control of my thoughts and my speech? Does that make sense? I'll repeat that. It's a very important concept to understand. If the commandments can be broken by thought or by speech, in addition to actions, and if only commandment keepers will be in heaven, then if I want to be in the kingdom of heaven, I must get in control of my thoughts and my speech. Now let me tell you, friends, we are living in a world where very few people are in control of their thoughts and their speech. Have you noticed that in the news? Very few people are in control of their thoughts and their speech. So I have a hard question for you. You ready for this? What's going to happen to these people when Jesus comes? Well, let's start to study. Open your Bible to Matthew 5, and we'll read where we were reading our scripture. Now, this scripture is about the sixth commandment. This is Matthew 5, 21 to 26. It's about the sixth commandment. The sixth commandment says, "You shall not murder." By the way, it's not talking about insects like mosquitoes or even animals. It's not talking about that. It's talking about human beings. When you kill a fly or destroy a pest, that's not breaking the sixth commandment. Breaking the sixth commandment is if you kill a human being. And so the people that Jesus was talking to, when he said, "You've heard of old that people said you shall not murder," they said to them, "Well, of course, I know that. I'm not a person like that. I would never do anything like that." Isn't that what people think? In fact, we're so confident that we don't break the sixth commandment that preachers don't very often talk about the sixth commandment in church. We'll talk about the other commandments. The sixth commandment, we'll say, "Well, we keep that. We don't have a problem with that." That's what they thought. Until Jesus went on speaking in verse 22. Now, verse 22 is so strict. Are you listening? That when we read our scripture this morning, it was not the correct verse. Because it's not the correct verse probably in your Bible. Because starting in the second century, when copyists were copying the Bible, and they copied Matthew 5:22, there were people that said, "If that is so, Jesus would be a sinner himself, because it says in the book of Mark that Jesus himself was angry with the people. And so Jesus would be a sinner himself, and that's impossible." So they decided, there has to be something, there has to be a problem here. And so they inserted one more Greek word, which translates into English, "without cause." And by doing that, they not only softened it up, they destroyed 99% of the meaning of the verse. I've studied this verse for a few decades. I've checked what I'm talking to you about very carefully for many years. I realized many years ago already that I have never, ever seen a person who is angry without cause. I've never seen one. You remember the story of Jonah, and God said to him, "Do you well to be angry?" He said, "Most certainly I do. I do well to be angry unto death." That's what Jonah said. Did he say he had cause to be angry? I have never, ever met a person who was angry that didn't have cause. So if you say you should not be angry without a cause, that doesn't mean very much. Everybody would qualify that. That's not what Jesus said. If you look in manuscript P64, which is written about 200 or several other of the ancient manuscripts, you'll find out that this is what Jesus said. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother shall be in danger of the judgment. Any person who is angry with his brother, there is no such thing as having cause to be angry with your brother. Now, there is cause to be angry that God has been dishonored, but not angry with your brother. Now, I know that somebody's going to say, well, you don't know the situation that I'm in. I probably don't. And you don't know how evil this person has been or what wrong they've done. That's true. I can tell you some awful stories on that regard. But that is still what Jesus said. The Christian religion is the most strict religion in the world because this Christian religion requires me to be in control of my thoughts and my emotions. Anger is an emotion. Let me read to you what was going through the minds of these people as Jesus was talking to them. This is from the book Mount of Blessings, page 56. By the way, let me say something else about the writings of Ellen White, so somebody might be confused about this. Ellen White, in her writings, especially in the first 40 or 45 years of her ministry, she quoted almost always from the King James Bible because that was the only Bible that was available. But when other versions became available, she began to quote sometimes from them. And if you look at the book Mount of Blessings, when she quotes this verse, she quotes it from the Revised Version. You know why she quotes it from the Revised Version? Because in the Revised Version, it reads, everyone who is angry with his brother shall be in danger of the judgment. Drop that. We could spend a long time looking at that. We don't have time to do that. Just drop that subject. But I wanted you to know that what I'm telling you is supported not just by scholarship, but it's supported by the spirit of prophecy. These people, where Jesus was talking, this is a Sermon on the Mount. There on the mountainside, they could look out across the Sea of Galilee. And on the other side of the Sea of Galilee, there was a land called the land of Bashan. And it was a land that was thick forest and mountains and gorges, very rugged country. And it was a country where a lot of criminals hung out. In fact, Ellen White says that at the very time Jesus was speaking, a short time before, there had been report of robberies and murders in that land. And they were looking out across there and they said, yep, I believe it was, the Bible says, thou shalt not murder. And they were thinking about these murders that had been committed and these robberies they had committed. And there were people in the audience that had denounced these evildoers. And they knew that the commandment applied to them, but they didn't realize that the commandment applied to them until Jesus said, verse 22, he that's angry with his brother should be in danger of the judgment. Here's what you read on Mount of Blessings, page 56. At the same time, they were themselves passionate and contentious. They cherished the most bitter hatred of their Roman oppressors, and felt themselves at liberty to hate and despise all other peoples, even their own countrymen who did not in all things conform to their ideas. In all this, they were violating the law which declares, thou shalt not kill. And then this statement, the next paragraph. The spirit of hatred and revenge originated with Satan, and it led him to put to death the Son of God. Whoever cherishes malice, that's animosity, malice, wishing evil on somebody, or unkindness. Do I have unkind thoughts toward those that oppose me? Now, I'm not asking the question formally because I don't want anybody to raise their hand, but is there anybody in this room or is there anybody in this town that doesn't have anybody that opposes them, that doesn't have any enemies? Probably not. Whoever cherishes malice or unkindness is cherishing the same spirit, and its fruit will be unto death. In the revengeful thought, the evil deed lies enfolded as the plant in the seed. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. That's 1 John 3:15. Hatred, again, is an emotion. So the Christian religion requires me to be in control of my thoughts and my emotions. If I am not in control of my thoughts and my emotions, I am not a Christian. Not really. I may profess Christianity as my religion, but I am not a Christian because a Christian is Christ-like. I am not really a Christian because I am not in control of my thoughts and my emotions. Now think this through. If I am not in control of my thoughts and emotions, there's going to come a time I'm not going to be in control of my speech. And if I am not in control of my thoughts and my emotions, there's going to come a time I will not be in control of my actions. Now, when it gets to actions, then the state gets involved. But Jesus points out here, the sin is not when you actually do that, it's when it's going on in your mind. That's where it starts. And the gospel is a system to solve the sin problem, and to solve the sin problem, it has to be solved in the mind. The Christian warfare, sometimes we talk about Christian warfare, the Christian warfare is almost all mental. That's what Christian warfare is. It's a warfare that takes place in the mind. Am I in control or am I not in control? Now, I mentioned that the second thing we're going to study is about the commandments. And as we've already studied the sixth commandment, as in the Sermon on the Mount, we've already studied the sixth commandment, and that commandment is broken when? It's broken when a person is not in control of their feelings and they develop animosity, unkindness, anger, malice in the mind. They haven't done anything, but they've still broken the sixth commandment, broken in the mind. Now, if it's in the mind long enough, something's going to happen in the mouth. We know that because Jesus said it. Jesus said in Matthew 12, he said, out of the abundance of the heart, that's the mind, the mouth speaks. So if it's in my mind long enough, and you know there's a lot of people that pride themselves and they say, well, I've thought all this, but I haven't done it. But let me tell you, if you think it long enough, something's going to happen. If you think about it long enough, something's going to happen. So if a person has negative feelings toward a brother or a sister, somebody in their family, somebody in the church, eventually, you know what's going to happen? They're going to talk about it. They're not going to talk about it, probably, to the person. They'll talk about it to somebody else. And when I have a problem with you and I don't talk about it to you, I talk about it to somebody else, that's what the Bible calls backbiting. Now, do you know what the Bible says about backbiting? Well, in the scripture, it's in Romans 1, backbiters are classed with haters of God. If a person is a hater of God, are they keeping the first commandment? Absolutely not. They're breaking the first commandment. Concerning backbiters, The scripture says that in God's sight, those people are worthy of death. Read the last several verses in Romans 1. You'll see it. One of the chapters that many years ago I memorized, and then I let it slip. But several days ago, I decided I was going to re-memorize it so I could say it. And I know I can say it now. I'm not going to take the time to say it to you right now, but I can say the whole chapter. I know I can because I've said it in bed and when I was half asleep several times this last week, sometimes this last week. It's Psalm 15. In Psalm 15, it lists 11 characteristics that you must have if you're going to be in the kingdom of heaven. You might want to look at Psalm 15. We won't take time to give the whole chapter. But I want you to notice in Psalm 15, out of the 11 things that are mentioned, 11 characteristics that you must have if you're going to be in the kingdom of heaven, 4 have to do with speech. For instance, the person that's going to be saved has to be a person that, verse 2, speaks the truth in his heart. It has to be a person, verse 3, that does not backbite with his tongue. It has to be a person, in verse 3, that does not take up a reproach against his neighbor. And it also has to be a person, in verse 4, who swears to his own hurt and doesn't change. So, a large part of your record. You know, we each have a record in the kingdom of heaven. God has a record book. And in his record book, you have a page. And on that page in your record book, there is listed. Are you listening? There is listed every thought that you have ever thought since you were born. It's all there. It's listed every feeling and emotion and imagination that has been in your mind ever since you were born. It's all there. And also listed there is every word that you have ever spoken. Not only the word, but the tone of your voice. Everything can be reproduced. The Lord can show it to you anytime. That's in addition to all of your actions. That's why Jesus said, by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. In the book Education, page 235 and 236 and 237, we won't take time to read at length from those pages. But in those pages, if you have the book Education, look at this afternoon at pages 235, 236, and 237. There's a lengthy section there about speech. She says on page 235, the chief requisite of language is that it be pure and kind and true. There's two commandments right there. If your speech is true, then it's not breaking the seventh. If it's true, you're not breaking the ninth commandment. And if it's pure, you're not breaking the seventh commandment. You can break the seventh commandment with impure speech. You can break the ninth commandment with untrue speech. God's word also condemns the use of meaningless expletives. Meaningless phrases that border on profanity. This is page 236. It condemns the deceptive compliments. You know, you don't really believe the compliment you're giving this person, but you're giving it to them because you want to get a promotion in your job. You want to keep them on your side so they don't give you any trouble at the office. It condemns the deceptive compliments, the evasions of truth, the exaggerations, that's breaking the ninth commandment, the misrepresentations in trade. Let me ask you this question. Why do people misrepresent in trade? Why? If you're the buyer, what you want to get the price down. So the Bible says that the buyer says, it's nothing. But when he's gone, he boasts that he got such a good deal. What's he trying to do? He's trying to steal from the seller. Many years ago, when my aunt was alive, I had an aunt that lived near Eugene, Oregon. She used to have a painting by Norman Rockwell in one of the bathrooms in her house. It's an old painting, probably back from the 30s. And in this painting, a lady, is when they had the old spring scale. You remember those old spring scales? You put the food on the scale and then it would go down a little bit and you would read it at the top how many pounds it was. And it was one of those spring scales. So it's hanging there and the lady is there to buy a chicken to go to cook for dinner. And the man that's selling the chicken, he's standing on the other side. And you look at the painting and you can see what they can't see. The lady has her hand under the spring pushing it up. The man on the other side, he has his finger on the spring, pushing it down. The buyer is trying to cheat the seller, and the seller is trying to cheat the buyer. That's breaking the Eighth Commandment. The misrepresentations in trade that are current in society and in the business world, let your speech be yes, yes, no, no. Whatever is more than these is of the evil one. Matthew 5:37. Well, see, the Sermon on the Mount is about one of the big subjects, is about the commandments, and that they can be broken by thought or emotion in it, or speech in addition to actions. What is the basis of the whole law anyway? The basis, the foundation principle of the law of God is that I'm to love God with all my heart, soul, and mind. I don't know about you, but I pray about this. Let me ask you a question for you to just think about for a moment. Do you love God with all your heart, soul, and mind? Some time ago, I became convicted that I did not. And I said, Lord, I need to be converted. I need to have a different heart. I need to have a different mind. I need to appreciate what you've done for me like I haven't done. If I don't love God supremely, what the next thing that'll happen is I won't love my neighbors myself. But if I do love God supremely, how will it affect the way I treat somebody that Jesus Christ died on the cross for? It'll affect the way I treat my fellow men. This is what Ellen White wrote in Review and Herald, May 3, 1898. To love God with all the heart is the first great law of the universe. When the love of God fills the heart, love to our fellow men will flow forth in words and deeds as the fruit of that love. These passionate words are a savor of death unto death. He who utters them is not cooperating with God, but with Satan. In heaven, his wicked railing is placed in the same list as swearing. Uh-oh, now we just covered the third commandment. Remember, one of the major topics we're going to study is the commandments. One of the major things that Jesus talked about in the Sermon on the Mount. We just covered the third commandment. These passionate words. It's in the same category in heaven. It's written down, swearing. Now, I want to spend just a moment or two, hopefully not more than a moment or two, on the problem of passionate words. Do you know what one of the principal problems of passionate words are? One of the principal problems is when a person is speaking passionate words, their reason is disengaged. It's not in control anymore. They're being controlled by their emotions and not by intellect or reason. And there was a student in our college in Battle Creek that had this problem. He would become passionately angry. And Ellen White wrote to him, And I want to read you just a few sentences of what she wrote to this young man in volume 4, page 431. She's talking about the school. She said, "Study critically the character of the government of our school. The rules which were enforced were none too strict." Ellen White says, this man decided the rules are too strict. Ellen White says, the rules were not too strict. Have you ever noticed that when young people decide that the rules are too strict, that they get rebellious against the rules? Have you noticed that? Get rebellious. That's what happened to this young man. She says, but anger was cherished for the time being, reason was dethroned, and the heart was made a prey for ungovernable passion. What happened in this young man? He became angry, and as a result, for the time, his reason was dethroned. It was not in control. And the heart was made prey to ungovernable passion. Remember, passion is an emotion. And emotions, are you listening? Emotions are not rational or reason. They have nothing to do with ration or reason. They are feelings. By the way, to show you how fast they can be changed, I mustn't get into this and waste time. But it was an astonishment of my life. Many times I've watched this. Back in the days before we had all the digital age, and didn't even have sound with the movies, I knew a man. They used to hire people as organists, and when they would play a movie, the organist had to play music that would help to set the mood for what the people were thinking on the screen. And if you've ever watched those things, it's an astonishing thing what can be done. The organist can change your feelings in seconds just by changing what the tune he's playing on the machine. Emotions are not rational. They can be changed by music. They can be changed by drugs. They can be changed by all sorts of things. You want to be under control of emotions and feelings and not rational? Let me tell you, friend, nobody will be taken to the kingdom of heaven who is not in control, because it would make heaven a dangerous place. She went on to write this young man. She said, impulse had overcome reason. You could not recall the injury done to yourself or nor the institution of God. Our only safety under all circumstances is in being always master of ourselves in the strength of Jesus, our Redeemer. That is our only safety. Our only safety. Somebody might say, well, Pastor John, you just don't realize this person that I'm dealing with, you don't realize how evil they are and how many weaknesses of character that they have. And that may be true. I'm not arguing with you that point. Let me ask you a question. Are you planning on having perfect control of your thoughts and your emotions after that person overcomes whatever weaknesses of character they have? Well, let me ask you this question. What if you die before that happens? Have you thought that through? The way, when I hear some people talk, I think, well, they're waiting, they're gonna develop perfect control of their emotions and their feelings after this other person gets over their weakness and their trouble. What if that other person never overcomes their weakness? What if they're lost? You want to be lost too? Let me read you something interesting about that. This is right out of Matthew, the 5th chapter, verses 22 and 23. Whoever shall say to his brother, Raca, vain fellow, shall be in danger of the council. In the gift of his Son for our redemption, God has shown how high a value he places upon every human soul. And he gives to no man liberty to speak contemptuously of another. We shall see faults and weaknesses in those about us. But God claims every soul as his property, his by creation and doubly his as purchased. One of our problems is, friend, Do you realize how valuable, how precious you are in God's sight? Remember, your neighbor is just as valuable as you are. Even if he has character weaknesses right now that he hasn't overcome. God claims every soul is his property, his by creation, and doubly his as purchased by the precious blood of Christ. All were created in his image. And even the most degraded are to be treated with respect and tenderness. God will hold us accountable for even a word spoken in contempt of one soul for whom Christ laid down his life. You ready to go to the judgment? Give account of your words? Friends, if we speak contemptibly about somebody else, we say, well, you don't know how bad they are. Doesn't matter how bad they are. Doesn't matter how degraded they are. No matter how degraded another human being is, I have no right to speak contemptibly of that person. I'm to treat that person with courtesy and tenderness and respect. That's what Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, if you say, vain fellow, that's where the word raka means, then you're putting yourself in a situation where you will have to give an account, and it won't be pleasant for you to give the account. How many commandments have we covered? We've covered the sixth commandment, the seventh commandment, the eighth commandment, the ninth commandment, the third commandment. Here's the first commandment. This is a letter that Ellen White wrote, part of a letter that Ellen White wrote to her children. Do not think that your state is good enough and make no effort to get nearer to God unless you overcome pride of dress, pride of heart, love of self, all anger, and every evil passion. God will not own you as his and will not receive you to himself at his appearing. You can be overcomers. Go to God daily for strength and every day overcome. Notice, the first commandment has to do with having no other gods before you, but God will not acknowledge you as his if you do not overcome all anger and evil passion. Now, what we're talking about is very unpopular theology today. We're living in a time, remember Paul said in the last days that people would have a form of godliness but deny the power. People today want an easy religion. They do not want a religion where you have to fight. And what we're talking about requires a fight. Is it true that it requires a fight to get to be in control of your thoughts and your emotions? Does that require a fight or not? It requires a fight. And there's a lot of people that don't want a religion that requires a fight. But New Testament Christianity does require a fight. It requires a fight until I am in control of my thoughts and my feelings. Here is a statement that Ellen White wrote to parents that is actually very, very encouraging. It says, by some, a constant battle is maintained for self-control. Some people have to fight all the time, all day long, in order to have self-control. Daily they strive silently and prayerfully against harshness of speech. They're striving, they're fighting, so that they don't speak harshly. There are some people that don't realize that harshness of speech is wrong until they get on the receiving end of it, and then they find out that they don't enjoy it at all. And some of us have had a problem in that so that we can speak harshly without even thinking about it. And we have to pray and say, Lord, help me to overcome that. Because they don't speak that way in heaven. They don't use harsh speech in heaven. Daily they strive silently and prayerfully against harshness of speech and temper. These strivings may never be appreciated by human beings. They may get no praise from human lips for keeping back the hasty words which sought for utterance. The world will never see these conquests, and if it could, it would only despise the conquerors. But in heaven's record, they are registered as overcomers. There is one who witnesses every secret combat and every silent victory. Are you having any of those? Let me lay out a challenge. If there's anybody in this room that doesn't believe the Christian religion is real, if you don't believe that there's a God in heaven that has control of things, if you commit your life to God and then say, Lord, by your grace, I'm going to try to get in control of my thoughts and my emotions and my words, and I pray that you'll help me, you'll find a miracle to start happening in your life. And you will know that God is real. Nobody can tell you that he doesn't exist because you've had his power revealed in your life. Until you have God's power revealed in your life, you will not have victory in your life. That's why Mark Twain said, he said, it isn't hard to stop smoking. I've quit 1,000 times. What does that mean? That means he started back up at least 999 times. But when you've tried to do something 1,000 times and you can't do it, don't raise your hand, don't change the expression on your face, just keep a poker face so that those around you won't know what you're thinking. But let me ask you this question. Is there any problem in your life, in the control of your emotions or your thoughts or your words, that you have tried hundreds of times to break and you weren't able to do it? If that's the case, then what you need is divine help. And there is divine help. By the way, since we're on that, let me give you a tip that I've found to be very, very helpful. When you are under temptation, whether it's to break the 7th commandment in your mind and to break the 6th commandment in your mind by getting angry or whatever it is, when you're under temptation, if you have memorized scripture, you will find that when you start to quote the scriptures, the gears will shift in your mind. Your mind won't be on that over there, that anger that's trying to run. Your mind will be on this, these scriptures that you memorized. And if you memorize lots of scriptures, then you have lots of ammunition when the devil comes to you with temptations, because you have a way to get your mind on something else and to get in control. Pray about it. If this wasn't possible to do, then the gospel wouldn't have been given. But Jesus came and gave us this instruction because through his grace it is possible. And it has to happen in order for you and for me to be ready to go to heaven. The habit of, this is about the school. This is again in the book Education, page 235. The teacher can do much to discourage that evil habit, the curse of the community, the neighborhood, and the home. The habit of backbiting, gossip, ungenerous criticism. In this, no pains should be spared. Impress upon the students the fact that this habit reveals a lack of culture and refinement and of true goodness of heart. It unfits one both for the society of the truly cultured and refined in this world, and for association with the holy ones of heaven. You don't want to do something that would unfit you for association with those in heaven or with the cultured people in this world. Jesus is coming soon. And when Jesus returns, A quote from Review and Herald, May 5, 1903. He that loves pureness of heart for the grace of his lips, the king shall be his friend. Proverbs 22:11. On the Savior's coronation day, he will not acknowledge as his any who bear spot or wrinkle. He will not acknowledge any as his who have spot or wrinkle. You know, friends, we're living in a time when there's an awful lot of pretending going on. The problem is there's a lot of people today who are pretending to be Christians. But they're not in control of their thoughts, they're not in control of their feelings, and they're not in control of their words. They could be called pretend Christians. If I am a pretend Christian, I need to be converted. Otherwise, my religion is for nothing. In 18 Manuscript Religious, page 206, I read this statement. Christ will have nothing to do with pretense. He will welcome to the heavenly courts only those whose Christianity is genuine. The lives of those professing Christians who do not live the life of Christ are a mockery to religion. If I really want to go to heaven, remember, the bottom line we talked about right at the first is, what must I do to be saved? Christ answered that question in the Sermon on the Mount. Only commandment keepers will be in heaven. But keeping the commandments involves being in control of my thoughts and my feelings, and as a result of that, then I'll be in control of my tongue and I'll be in control of my actions. But there are some people who, while they pretend to be commandment keepers, are breaking them all the commandments, because they don't love God with all their heart, soul, and mind, and they don't love their neighbors themselves. And if I do not love God with all my heart, soul, and my mind, and if I don't love my neighbor as myself, I'm breaking all the commandments. Let me read that to you. Christ has promised to make them harmonious on every point, not pleasant and agreeable and kind today, and tomorrow harsh and disagreeable and unkind, falsifying their profession of faith. Have you ever known a Christian like that? They might be called a spotted Christian or a leopard Christian. They're hot today and cold tomorrow. They're wonderful today. Boy, you can't stand to be around them tomorrow. There are Christians like that, professed Christians like that, but that's not the real thing. But many refuse to place themselves where he can help them. They are breaking the commandments of God, for they have left their first love. What's the remedy? Well, what should I do? If suppose that somebody really has done something really evil against me. Am I saying that I should do nothing? No, I'm not saying I should do nothing. But if somebody has done something really evil against me, instead of going and talking to the other people in the church about it, I should go right and talk to them about it. That's what Jesus said in Matthew 18. Turn to Matthew 18 for just a moment. Matthew 18 is a very interesting, the whole chapter is about this subject. In Matthew 18, Peter came to Jesus and he said, well, now if my brother does sin against me, does something really bad against me, how many times should I forgive him? Now they had a rule among the Jews, some of the Sadducees and the Pharisees, they said, well, you should forgive somebody three times. So after you've told them that you forgive them three times, I guess the next time you can tell them that they can go to hell. Because you've forgiven them three times and now they did it again. So Peter thought when he came to Jesus and to ask about this. He thought that if he said that he would forgive his brother seven times, that would be very, very generous. He said, "How shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times?" That's the time when Jesus said, "I don't say to you till seven times, but until 70 times seven." And it was at this occasion that Jesus told this story in Matthew 18, verses 21 to 35. And Peter's question is in verse 21. But up in verse 15, Jesus said what to do if your brother sins against you. Now, by the way, there's a lot of people that I get letters all the time. People say, "Oh, you're not following Matthew 18. Matthew 18:15 is not talking about when somebody does something that I don't like. That is not talking about that. It's talking about when my brother sins against me. Sin is when they break the law against me. They tell me a lie, steal from me. They commit a sin against me. What shall I do?" He says, "Go," and that's verse 15, "go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. If he won't hear you, well, then take one or two more." Ellen White says about that this: when you're going to talk to your brother who sinned against you, she says, "Talk quietly together." Talk quietly. "Let no angry words escape your lips. Present the subject in a way that will appeal to his best judgment. And if he will hear you, you have gained him as a friend. Whatever the character of the offense may be, this does not change the plan God has made for the settlement of misunderstandings and personal injuries. Act out the spirit of Christ. Take the recipe God has provided and carry it to the spiritually diseased one. Give him the remedy that will cure the disease of disaffection. Do your part to help him. Feel that it is a duty and privilege to do this for the sake of the unity and peace of the church, which is very dear to the heart of Christ. He does not want any wound to remain unhealed on any member of his church." Did you know that? Did you know that right now, if you have any wound that has been inflicted on you by anybody in your family or in the church, the Lord does not want that wound to remain unhealed. He wants it to be healed. Would you like it to be healed? All heaven is interested in the interview between the injured member and the one who has been guilty of error. After settling the difficulty together, pray, and the angels of God will come to you and bless you. There is music in heaven over this union. As the erring one accepts the testimony borne and gives evidence of true repentance, the sunshine of heaven fills his heart. Hearts are drawn together. The healing oil of love removes the disease and soreness of the wrong. The Holy Spirit binds heart to heart. Those who have been united in Christian fellowship offer prayer to God and pledge themselves to deal justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God. If they have wronged others, they continue the work of repentance, confession, and restitution, and the disease is healed. If I've wronged my brother, what am I to do so that I get healed and he gets healed? Notice the three things: repentance, confession, and restitution. Restitution is when I've stolen something from you. If I make restitution, that means I give it back. I give it back with interest. What's the recipe for being healed? Repentance, confession, restitution. They are fully set to do good to one another. This is the fulfilling of the law of Christ. Repentance, confession, and restitution are all required. These cannot atone for sin, for God has been wronged in the person of his saints. The Lord Jesus alone is able to atone for sin by the application of his blood shed for the guilt of the sinner. His blood cleanses from all sin. Let me ask you, friend, do you want to be healed? I want to be healed. I want to be in a condition so that the Lord can look at me and say, this person loves me with all their heart, soul, and mind, and they love their neighbors themselves. And friends, when that time happens, then you will be ready to go to the kingdom of heaven. You will be saved when the Lord comes. Let's pray before we sing our closing song that we can each have that experience. Father in heaven, we thank you that when we were ruined, that you devised a way that our bruises and wounds could be healed, and that we could be made whole again, and that our guilt could be taken away, and that we could be restored as members of the royal family. We pray that the gospel may be to us not just a story, but an experience that we are experiencing day by day in our mind, in our heart, and the way we speak. We pray that you will cause the plan of salvation to get worked out in each one of our lives, so that in that great day when our Lord returns in the clouds of heaven, we may be ready to meet him with joy and peace. We pray this in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.